podcast is being brought to you by the Defy Life Podcast Network.
Maybe we can still heal you.
Why? So you can just lock me up? No. Just bury me in the ocean with my ancestors that jumped from the ships, because they knew death was better than bondage.
Oh, you think darkness is your ally? You merely adopted the dark. I was born in it, molded by it. I didn't see the light until I was already a man. By then, it was nothing to me but blight. The shadows betray you because they belong to me.
In the hell do you think you are?
Okay, it's not working out. I'm going to need the suit back.
For how long?
Forever.
Yeah, let's
have it.
No, please.
Let's have it.
You don't understand. This is all I have. I'm nothing without this suit.
If you're nothing without this suit, then you shouldn't have it, okay?
So, Oz, this week, we are going to not only talk about WandaVision, the latest two episodes before we get ready for the big finale, we are also going to give our final spotlight actor or actress for the Black History Month. Oz, you know, we've seen you not have a pulse on the people, but last week you got you started to get a little bit of one. So we're going to find out if that's going to continue now. Oz, our four choices for our spotlight of the week were Eddie Murphy, Viola Davis, Samuel L. Jackson, and Jada Pinkett Smith. Oz, who do you think came in last?
Jada Pinkett Smith.
With 5% of the vote, Jada Pinkett Smith is correct.
Mm-hmm.
5% mm-hmm. though, god dang.
I know, they yeah, it's kind of tough. Like, the whole family does.
That's what happens when you get an entanglement, so.
Well, and also, like, Will Smith carries the whole family, because the rest of the family people are like, eh.
Let's not be disrespectful. She's more than held her own.
She was in both Matrix movies, so.
Plenty of stuff before that, too. But yeah, she's more than held her own as an actress.
A different world.
Come on. So, Oz, out of the three, Eddie Murphy, Viola Davis, and Samuel L. Jackson, who do you think the people chose?
Oh, Sam, homie.
Okay.
Sam.
The correct answer is Eddie Murphy with 36% of the vote.
What?
Yeah. What do you think about that?
I think that's crazy.
Okay. Why do you think that's crazy?
Well, Eddie Murphy's held his own, but Samuel Jackson.
I'm just playing.
I know, dude.
No, you don't. Actually,
wait, hold on. I do know, because Samuel Jackson won.
Oh, so you already knew the poll. You already knew the poll.
Yeah.
Oh, well, why didn't you say that?
Because I didn't know the poll, but I know the polls.
No, you did know the poll, and you cheated.
No.
That doesn't count. I'm glad. Thank you for acknowledging that. I appreciate your honesty,
homie.
We will throw that one out.
Settle down. I know the pulse of the people. I didn't need to cheat, dude. That's come on, man. The least and the greatest of those four, that's an easy no-brainer right there.
I'm still throwing it out. I think he cheated.
You can throw whatever you want out. You can throw the baby out with the bathwater if you want to.
I will not be the one that tosses any babies out.
I won't be
throwing any babies.
You know, I'm just saying, man, like, it's a bit extreme doing that when you're just like, hey, let's just try the baby off. But, you know.
So who came? Okay, Mr. Pulse of the People. Who came in? Who came in? Who came in second? Who came in second? Mr. Pulse of the People.
I want to give it to Eddie, but Viola should get it. Viola came in second.
Okay, so who are you picking?
I said I want to give it to Eddie, but Viola came in second.
Well, actually, you said you wanted to give it to Viola, but you said Eddie. And then you said Viola came in second. So that's why I was confused.
I don't know about that. So, okay, here, make it easier for you. Viola.
With 29% of the vote, Viola Davis comes in second place.
So who came in third?
You tell me who came in third.
I'm going to have to go with Eddie. Is that right?
So let's say a couple nice things about the three people
me.
Who...
About me? You say a couple nice things about me.
That's okay. I don't need... I
know, it's tough. It's tough, bro.
I don't know if I could come up with three.
So Uncle Oz, with the pulse of the people...
You have no pulse of the people. Are you cheating?
Wait, hold on, buddy. Wait. Friend. Regular, as George Clooney said to Chris O'Donnell in his monologue, my comrade, my friend.
I don't think he said my comrade.
He said brother, comrade. So I was just going, okay, what the fuck is going on here?
He didn't say comrade. He didn't say amigo. He might have said pal. He might have said pal. But he did not say comrade or amigo, compadre.
Bosom buddy. He said something crazy to me. I was like, that is crazy.
No, he said, how about a partner? And then that's when Chris O'Donnell was like, how about a friend? Right? Wasn't that how it went?
Chris O'Donnell, he said the same thing to Batgirl. Batgirl was like, why you take your pants off on a rooftop?
Nah, my family's Uncle Alfred. Oh, and then, let's not forget that Jim, that Barbara Gordon is Alfred's niece all of a sudden.
That's why everybody hates Bruce.
Yeah, I wonder how that universe turns out when Barbara and Bruce eventually hook up.
Yeah, think about that all universe there where it's just like everyone's having their fun with Barbara, even the Joker, and Alfred's like, what the fuck is wrong with y'all?
And look, there's no Jason Todd because Chris O'Donnell becomes Red Hood.
Yeah, so I'm just saying, man, that's Earth 4776623333.
I don't think it's that one.
I was off by a digit.
Okay. Oz, as briefly as someone of your rant stature can, let's say
say a couple words about being adult, about the pulse of the people. I'll be happy to say that. Let me explain that in term.
Let's start with the bottom of the bottom. Jada Pinkett Smith.
She, as we all know, is the partner of Will Smith. They had a brief entanglement. but, dude... she has held her own. She's been in a ton of stuff. She's immortalized for nerdums for at least being in The Matrix 2 and 3. She's had her own sitcom and series on various networks. She and her daughter do a really introspective roundtable with various guests, usually women. Most time women and women of color, just talking about what it means to be to be a woman. And to wrap it up, there's a cool term that's been floating around that during the 60s, during the Black Liberation Movement, there's this focus on like Black men getting their rights and stuff like that. So there's another focus on white women getting their rights, which became feminism. So, in the answer for Black women, which I'm bringing to Jada Pinkett Smith, is that instead of feminism, they're starting to coin a term called womanism, which is like inclusive of all women. So I feel like she really embodies that term, her and her daughter and their relationship and their stuff they talk about. I look forward to her stuff. She's just really smart.
That's the show you're referring to is Red Table Talk. And let's not forget that she also had an entanglement with the legendary Tupac.
Yes, that's very, very true. She, yes.
As you know, that's just a little extra little pointer in there, you know?
But she's more than her entanglement, so we'll move it on.
let's go to Viola Davis. Let's stick with the ladies.
Well, no, let's go to number three in order.
That's okay. Go to Viola Davis.
Eddie Murphy, people know that cat from Delirious, from Raw. If you haven't seen Raw and Delirious, their stand-up, that is where the Chris Rock got his juice. That's where Dave Chappelle got his juice. That's where Cat Stevens got his juice. You know, that's where all the modern day black men that we love now, Eddie Murphy ushered them in. Not to mention the fact that he was like one of the few original black cast members on SNL. And when he came on, it was crazy. Like, he had his whole spoof about Too Hot in the Hot Tub, which everybody remembers. Kill My Landlord, C-I-L-L, My Landlord. He was in, Best Defense? Dan Aykroyd, I believe. But he also made his break as the beloved cop in Beverly Hills Cop 1, 2, and 3. Also, as another cop. He played a lot of cops, 48 hours, another 40 hours.
You don't have to go through his whole thing. This is supposed to be brief.
Okay, sorry, Emily. He did some major bombs like Pluto Nash. He's had a couple entanglements too. I look forward to seeing what he has to do. I still haven't seen him in a very hardcore dramatic role. So,
right, because he wasn't in Dreamgirls. Go ahead and go
that's a musical. Like Chris Rock, I just watched Chris Rock do Fargo. I could see Eddie Murphy play that character. I would like to have seen him do that. So anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, but being in a musical doesn't mean it's not a serious role.
Absolutely, dude. Hamilton.
Okay. Viola.
Viola Hamilton. Viola Davis. She is Angela Bassett has been in the game forever, but started getting her comeuppance recently. A lot of the fandoms and nerdoms would appreciate her from Suicide Squad. But I think she's within herself a nice little powerhouse. And by the way, she was also, I think, in Fences with Denzel Washington, too. I like her stuff because she plays just a quintessential, her characters have an inner drive that I really appreciate.
Great. Okay, so Samuel Jackson won the poll and was chosen by the people. So we will be going through his movie catalog. Later on in the show.
I'm going to go upstairs and eat some food. Great.
Oh, man. But before we get too deep into things, allow me to set the table.
I'm gonna go make some bread. Great. Jesus.
I'm gonna go turn some butter. This is Take a Knee for Marvel versus DC. I am your host, Regular Scott. I am here with my co-host, the comic connoisseur, the mighty Ozzy Kilmonger. Oz, what's going on?
What is up, my comic comrades?
And you can find us on Twitter at Ne4MarvelVerseDC. That's the number 4. You can email us, Ne4MarvelVerseDC@GoToFireLife.com. You can also find us on Facebook and Instagram at TakeANeForMarvelVerseDC. You can also join our Facebook group where we have great conversations all the time. We post some nice artwork. There's a lot going on there. You can also leave us a voicemail, 804-518-6631. Don't forget to check us out on TeePublic. We have masks, t-shirt, hoodies. Got a lot of gear out there. We got Uncle Oz and Thought. We have our classic logo. We have our new logo. There's a lot going on. Make sure you check out GoDefyLife.com, the podcast hub. That is where all of the Go Defy Life is. Check us out. Tell everyone where they can find you on your socials.
You can find me on the Twitter at OzzyReal. And I keep forgetting to tell people. It's at OzzyReal, because most people might have been spelling like Ozzy Osbourne. You know, I have not been the head off of any bats yet, and I did say yet. So we'll see.
Great.
Great. We're gonna title this episode Enthusiasm. Great.
No, the title of the episode is just gonna be great. ...
What's your superpower? I'm regular. Everything's great.
So what'd you think about that show? Great.
It was great.
Great.
Hey, dude, how was the birth of your child? Great.
Great.
What'd you name your child? Great son.
So, Oz, obviously we're going to be talking about WandaVision. We got to go through Samuel Jackson's movie catalog. Yes. We have a Kilmonger Yes. Go ahead. Yes. Go ahead.
Pardon me, sir.
Yes, please. Pardon yourself.
Make sure we talk about food.
Okay. Golly.
Great.
Speaking of food, what are your thoughts on Frosted Flakes? Speaking of great.
Are you serious?
Yeah, seriously.
Man, so.
Because I love Frosted Flakes. I'm just going to throw that out there.
No, dude. Like, when I was growing up, man, I was a Frosted Flakes fool. And when I couldn't get Frosted Flakes, I would get corn flakes and put a bunch of
sugar
in it.
On and it.
The sugar,
yeah.
And let the sugar just seep to the bottom of it.
And look, and then at the very end, you just eat the sugar with the milk.
You have sugar milk.
At the end, you just eat the sugar. That's great.
I got some sugar milk. Why do my teeth hurt? Why do I get all these cavities? So Frosted Flakes was cool, but you can also make some really cool treats with Frosted Flakes too. And people have been flipping the script. People have like crunched up Frosted Flakes and crumbled them on top of donuts. That's a little kind of crunchy thing. I'm a big fan, and I'm a big fan of Captain Crunch too.
What is the most overrated cereal?
Man, Grape Nuts suck.
You think that's the most over? You think people say that's a great cereal?
No, it just sucks.
Okay,
they
well, that's suck. Not what I asked you. I didn't ask what cereal sucks. There's plenty of cereals that suck.
Well, you know what? Here's my thing. Lucky Charms is overrated.
Hey, let me tell you something. Before you continue, let me just stop you. Let me just stop you right there. That was the exact cereal I was going to say was Lucky Charms, to be completely honest with you, because that is the most overrated cereal I've ever had.
Here it goes. The marshmallows suck, and the fucking...
It doesn't suck. It's just not as great as people say.
Dude, the actual oat cereal is... It always left a bad taste in my mouth.
The charms are good.
No, but you know what? The charms are just okay. Like, think about this. when you have Lucky Charms, you're like, okay, this is cool. The marshmallows are good, but you could have freaking, I don't know, like Twix. Or no, you could have Captain Crunch or whatever and be like, yo, this is like good stuff, dude, you know? I never seen anyone have a bag full of Lucky Charms without any milk. I've seen plenty of people take a bag full of Captain Crunch and Frosted Flakes and just eat it by itself.
Most underrated cereal.
That's a good one. You know the cereal that never really got the props that it should have got? Honeycombs.
Honeycombs are okay. They're okay.
Honeycombs are big. Yeah. They're not small.
They're great.
No, but I thought, what do you think? I think honeycombs, definitely.
Probably Honey Nut Cheerios.
You know what another cereal that on the download that I eat? Raisin Bran.
I mean, for what though? It's literally just cornflakes with raisins in it.
It's delicious. I still like it.
You could just get cornflakes and buy raisins.
Or I could just get.
Or you could pay $2 extra for the Raisin Bran. So
I think Raisin Bran are actually Frosted Flakes with raisins, but it's fine.
Is it frosted?
They're a little sweet. Well, okay. Actually, they're kind of sweet.
They're not sweet. They're not sweet at all.
Well, I'm just saying, dude. Well, let me ask you this: okay. What's your feeling? I know we have a lot to do today.
We do have a lot.
What's your feeling on smoked salmon?
No, I can't. I took a left turn from Raisin Bran and Cinnamon Toast Crunch cereal.
It's in some parts of the world, it's a delicious breakfast treat on a bagel with some lox and some capers and some cream cheese and a little bit of red onion. So I'm saying.
Well, I'm definitely good on it for breakfast. But as far as a lunch or dinner, I'm all about salmon. I love salmon. All about it.
But I'm saying smoked salmon, though. Have you had smoked salmon?
I don't think so, but I would be very open to trying it.
Okay, now see, I would like to.
Because I just like salmon. I like seafood.
Yeah, dude, me too. The wife does not like the seafood or mushrooms, and I love them.
My wife doesn't either. I wonder if it's a melanin thing.
Yeah, dude, so she doesn't like the fish either, huh?
I wonder if it's a melanin thing. Is that foul?
It could be a melanin. We need to take a poll.
Here's the thing, though. I don't have a lot of melanin myself, so.
But you still like the fish, though.
But
you're
I do still like the fish, you know?
You were raised on it. You know, Pops used to make the fish for us a lot.
Listen, I was raised on a fish fry.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I was raised on playing ball at the court and then going down the street to somebody's house and picking up a fish sandwich on the way.
Well, I'm going to tell you, dude, I was in the hospital with pneumonia when I was like in my 20s.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I was bad. I was sick. I was real sick. I was in the hospital and I couldn't eat any food. My dad came by and my dad came by and my dad was like, "You're not eating." And I was like, I can't eat anything. He's like, "I got you."
I'm going to tell you that ain't what he said. What he said was, "Hey, boy. You ain't eating nothing. What's wrong with you, boy? What's wrong with you?
To be very truthful, he was like, my mom's just like, "Oh, you look cute now." I'm like, "I just can't eat." Hey, boy. you see that food over there? I'm like, "Yeah." He goes,
Why are you not eating it?
I can't eat pop. He goes, "Well, I'm going to eat it. But you need to eat some food." So he started eating my food. And then he goes, "Don't worry. I got you." So the next day, he snuck all this hawk. We have a chain called Hawk's Fried Hawk's Seafood, Hawk's Barbecue. He snuck some Hawk's fried fish in, and I devoured that food, dude. I know I had the whole ward smelling like fish, but man, I devoured it, and I was out the hospital the next day. It's the healing power of fish.
Hey, let me tell you something. Dad go hard. He go hard at you, but he'll look out for you too.
But he makes some delicious fish, though, don't he?
He does make some very good fish. He's always making good fish.
Yeah, man. That's one thing I'll give you. But again, so traditionally what I've done before and what most people do, like in the Norwegian countries, right? You take your bread or your bagel, you put a little small smearing of cream cheese. If you don't have cream cheese, you can do hummus or whatever. Then you put some finely chopped onions. Red onions are good. Sweet onions are good. A sliver, which is a fillet, a little sliver of the smoked salmon on it with some capers. I've been doing pickles, and it's freaking amazing. It's delicious.
And that was How to Dress a Plate with Uncle Oz.
My segment, right?
Yeah, How to Dress a Plate with Uncle Oz. That's actually not a bad little thing. Okay, so yeah, there's your food talk for the day.
Thank you, sir. You know, I need that.
Yeah, you know, we got a little cereal. We shifted over to fish and salmon. We even got a hospital story out of it.
Well, I think it's because you're so enthusiastic about my last conversation. Great.
Well, I mean, Oz, let's keep it 100. You know, your energy, your personality, everything about you is just great.
No, let's keep it 100. I'm pretty boring. So.
Yeah, that's true. So, Oz, I'm gonna leave it up to you. What would you like to do next? Would you like to go to our Kilmonger conversation? Did you want to jump right into our spotlight actor? Do you want to do WandaVision now? We got a couple news tidbits that I do want to touch on today. What do you want to do?
Let's do Sammy just to knock him out real quick.
Okay. Well, first of all, don't disrespect him.
Mr. Jackson.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, Mr. Jackson. Sammy, I am for real.
You don't know that dude like that. Like, who do you think you are that you just calling people by a nickname that you don't even know is his?
But I feel like I know him.
Do you feel like he goes by Sammy? Does he look like he goes by Sammy?
I can tell you that dude, his mother probably is the only person in this universe that's ever called that dude Sammy. There's a movie exec that was like, "Hey Sammy, you just made us $1 million." He's like, "Motherfucker, I'm a Mr. Jackson."
He don't even have to say that. He just look at it like, "What the? Did you say,
dude? He's like, what's in your wallet? Because a gun's in my wallet." Oh, Mr. Jackson, thank you for all the money.
Yeah, anybody calling that dude Sammy?
Because if anybody's calling him Sammy, I would like to refer you all to his latest Twitter, where he was talking about during the insurrection on January 6th that Trump started craziness. He's saying that all his all the Trump supporters are saying, "Well, we're not going to support Samuel Jackson anymore. We're going to cancel him." Whatever he goes, he said, "You think I give a fuck? I cast that check already. I'm done with that. I've cashed that check. If you don't ever watch any more of my movies, I don't give a fuck."
Yeah, he good, man.
Dude, he is just real. He's just like, what?
Hey, look, he got a long list of movies, too. We about to be here for a minute. All right, let's...
Oh, I'm going to make it super quick with this.
Sure you are. Let's see how this goes. Actually, let's have a little fun, Oz. Let's have a little fun.
Okay, go ahead.
What is the very first movie listed in his filmography? I'll give you a hint. It's from 1972.
Oh, I can tell you.
Together for Days.
Yeah, but his biggest breakout, though, that really got him back in the game.
Well, we'll get to it.
Besides Electric Company.
Okay. Let's see here. We have a TV movie. 1977, The Displaced Person. He was in a TV movie, The Trial of Moak. Let's see here. Extra. I'm not going to do any extras. Ragtime, 1981.
Oh, yeah. With Gregory Hines.
A TV movie, 1987. Uncle Tom's Cabin. He played George.
So was Ragtime directed by Nick Castle?
No, it was directed by Milos Forman.
Okay, cool. Right, that's a different one. All right, good.
Let's see here. 1987, Magic Sticks. He plays a bum. He's working his way up. Spencer for Hire.
Yes.
He was in two episodes there. School Days, 1988. He plays Leeds.
Absolutely.
1988, another classic movie, Coming to America. He plays Hold Up Man.
He had a good year in 1988.
Let's see here, 1989, Do the Right Thing.
Yep.
Mr. Senor Love Daddy.
Spike Lee's favorite.
1989, Sea of Love.
Yeah.
He plays the black guy.
Is that Al Pacino and Michelle Pfeiffer.
Al Pacino and Ellen Barkin.
Damn.
John Goodman, Michael Rooker. Let's see here. 1990, A Shock to the System. Mm-hmm. He plays Ulysses. So no big roles here for Samuel L. Jackson yet.
Nope.
He's had a few movies, but nothing's really hitting yet. 1990, Death by Temptation.
Mm-hmm.
And not death, death.
Mm-hmm.
1990, Betsy's Wedding. He plays a taxi dispatcher.
Black guy.
Yep. 1990, Mo Better Blues.
Mm-hmm.
Madlock.
Another spiky.
1990. Go ahead.
Him and Spike have a very good relationship. Although Spike tried to break his back. Spike Lee won the Oscar recently. Really recently, won Oscar for Black Klansman, and Samuel Jackson was on stage. And Samuel Jackson's almost in his 80s, dude, or at least in his 80s, right? He's old. And Spike Lee won. He ran up on stage and jumped on Samuel Jackson. Samuel Jackson grabbed him and held him. I was like, what the?
Yeah, Samuel ain't no dude. Don't play with him.
Yeah, like, dude, don't be doing that, man.
The Exorcist 3 in 1990. Yeah. He plays the dream blind man.
Mythical black man. Yep. Mythical Negro. Yeah.
In 1990, he's in Goodfellas and plays Stax Edwards.
Okay. When's he smoking the TV?
I'm sorry?
When's he smoking the TV?
Oh, that's coming. Give it some time, dude. 1990, Return of the Superfly. He plays Nate Cabot.
Okay.
It's a starring role. We're getting closer to that lead role. 1991, Jungle Fever.
Gator.
There's another Spike Lee.
Gator. Mama, I smoked the TV.
There it is. 1991, Johnny Suede. And yes, he did play Gator Purify. 1991, Johnny Suede, he plays Bebop. I don't know what that is. Brad Pitt. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Brad Pitt plays Johnny Suede.
Yeah. He had a pompadour. Okay, moving on.
He was in an episode of Rock.
Yeah.
Classic series. Strictly Business, 1991. He plays Monroe.
Oh, yeah.
TV movie, Dead or Alive, The Race for Gus Ferris. He plays Hatcher.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So there's that. Tony Danza plays Gus Ferris.
Yeah. Who's the boss?
1991, Jumping at the Boneyard. He plays Mr. Simpson. 1992, Juice.
Hey, man. You get the juice now.
What you know about juice, Oz?
No, what you know about the juice, dude? Back him up. Stock him a little.
1992.
I guess I didn't know the ledge.
No, you didn't. 1992.
Knowledge is king. Dude, that's so good.
Fathers and Sons, he plays Marshall.
Is he a father or is he a son?
I'm just happy he's in the movie. 1992, White Sands, he plays Greg Meeker.
White dude on the beach.
He's black, so.
Black dude, White Sands.
Mickey Rourke and William Dafoe are also in that movie.
Ooh, dirties.
1992, The Patriot Games.
Whew.
He plays
He
plays Robbie. Harrison Ford is in this. Sean Bean.
Yep.
Let's see here. Now we're working our way up. He was in 3 episodes of Ghost Rider. Wow, I didn't know that. I used to love Ghost Rider.
Yeah, I'm sure you did.
Okay, thank you.
Great.
that was good. That was well timed. 1993, Loaded Weapon.
Oh yeah.
Get it. What's his name?
Estevan, Emilio Estevan.
Estevez. I'll give it to you. Yes, that is correct. Loaded Weapon 1.
Their spoof on Lethal beloved Danny Glover and beloved Mel Gibson when he's not drunk.
1993, Amos and Andrew.
Yes, spoofery. Is that with Tim Robbins?
That is with our boy, hashtag Leave Nick Alone.
Right, Hoda. Yes.
1993.
Hashtag Samuel Jackson needs a Starfleet uniform.
Let me ask you, while we're at 1993, before we get to the next movie, how do you think Samuel L. Jackson would have done as in the Star Trek universe?
Oof, man.
Could he have been that black Starfleet leader? Who was the black guy that led the that was head of the Enterprise?
With a smushed-in face?
No, he didn't have a smushed-in face. This black guy didn't have a smushed-in. He was bald, though.
Let me help you. There's never been a black guy that's led the Enterprise. You're referring to Benjamin Sisko from Deep Space Nine.
Oh.
You're getting close. But to be totally correct, there have been a couple episodes where Geordi LaForge, the black guy with the glasses, with the black guy with the hairband on his eyes, he has been in command of the Enterprise before. But you're referring to Avery Brooks, otherwise known as Hawk, from Spencer for Hire, 2 degrees of separation, bringing back to Samuel Jackson, as Benjamin Sisko, the Avatar.
Oh God!
Okay.
Hey, look, I just knew that guy was on Star Trek.
This dude talking about, when Legolas was on the Death Star on Star Trek.
You remember when Vader and Professor X were fighting on that spaceship?
And then the black dude
with the smushed in face came in with a laser.
Yeah, Professor X, he's the one that's got that lightning bolt on his forehead. his parents were killed in the store.
He's the one with the mark of the beast, right? He's the Antichrist, right? Professor X.
Oh my God.
All right. So listen. So now I'm figuring it out. So let me make sure I got this right. So Star Trek is the one with the blind black guy and the black guy with the smushed in face. And Deep Space Nine is the one with the black guy who actually does something.
Right, exactly.
Okay, got it. I just want to make sure I had it right.
And to help you out, now Voyager only has a black guy who's a Vulcan.
That's the one with the smushed in face, right?
No, Vulcans are the ones with the pointy ears.
What about their face?
Faces are kind of angular. They're okay.
So they're black elves.
They look like black elves.
So pretty much they're the black race of Legolas's kind.
So
those are the people that should have been on Middle Earth somewhere.
Well, so think of black people being discriminated against by white elves. They said, fuck it, we're leaving Middle Earth. And they decided to go to
they leave it. Hey, you wish it was that nice. They were kicked off the planet.
I know.
You wish it was that nice.
Gandalf's an asshole. Gandalf and all the elves were like, we got a spell for you motherfuckers.
So Legolas races.
What do you think? Vulcans only do logic because they're like, we ain't fucking with magic anymore, dude. We are only science, dude. Oh, all right. Magic got us kicked off Middle Earth, dude.
So I guess to bring it back full circle, Samuel L. Jackson would not have done well in Star Trek.
You know, I feel like Samuel Jackson would have been a Klingon, or he would have been like on the Maquis side, which are the rebels who don't go with any kind of organization.
Okay. Great. 1993.
Great.
1993. Menace to Society. He plays Tat Lawson. 1993 was a big year for him. 1993, Jurassic Park. He plays Arnold. That's a classic role.
This dude has been cashing a lot of checks.
A lot of franchises. Whew. Yeah, but you're right. He's been cashing a lot of checks. 1993, True Romance. He plays Big Don.
That is Quentin Tarantino, Brad Pitt, correct?
Yes, Brad Pitt is in it. I don't know if he's the star or not, but he's in it. Christian Slater, Val Kilmer, Dennis Hopper, Gary Oldman, Christopher Walken. It's a hell of a cast.
Yeah, the 90s were that. Yeah, that was a big one for him. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a big cast. 1994, Fresh. He plays Sam.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. 1994, he's in a TV movie, Assault at West Point, The Court Martial of Johnson Whitaker.
Yeah, okay.
He plays Richard Greener. This is the story of Johnson Whitaker, one of the first African-American cadets admitted to West Point. Tied down and beaten by his fellow cadets, Whitaker was court-martialed on the grounds that he staged his own assault to avoid taking a philosophy exam. His defense attorneys consisted of a racist and a Harvard graduate who squabble over how best to present his defense.
Right, except for seeing a bunch of white kids kick my ass.
Yeah, pretty much.
See, that reminds me of that crazy ass Robert De Niro movie and Cuba Gooding Jr. movie, which is based on true events of the first black frogman, which was like a Navy SEAL, right? So this dude, like, is getting harassed, like, by, like, his white peers. They're doing all this shit, almost killing them. And then finally, Robert Redford's character, who's the biggest racist of them all, is like, well, you know, I put you through hell, and you're still around. I think you can join. I'm like, what the fuck, dude?
They try to give him a redeeming moment.
Yeah. I'm just like, wait, hold on. You know, it's just a racist with a heart of gold. I was like, what? Man, you almost killed that dude underwater.
So if he wouldn't have survived, it would have been okay.
Would have been like, prove my point.
No, if he wouldn't have survived, he'd have been like, great.
No, if he wouldn't survive, it's like a no-win situation. It's like, prove my point. He ain't worth nothing. If he survives, it's like, okay, you survived.
Yeah, you're right. Let's see here. 1994 TV movie as well. He's back to the TV game. Against the Wall. He plays Jamal.
The Wall. Samuel Jackson's, I'm playing a wall.
he plays Jamal. Not the Wall.
Jamal the Wall.
1994, he's in Hail Caesar.
He's Caesar?
He plays the mailman.
Oh, God.
19... That dude was just like, hey, you want to give me a roll? I'm in.
How many zeros are in that check? Yeah, go ahead. I got you.
Six? Okay. 1994, Pulp Fiction.
Oh, yeah.
Winfield. 1994, The New Age. He plays Dale. Yeah. There's that. 1994, he's in the Search for the One-Eyed Jimmy.
Is that about sex?
He plays Colonel Ron.
Okay, good. At least he didn't play One-Eyed Jimmy.
Let's see what this is about. While working on a
I know what this is about.
While working on a documentary on his old neighborhood, a young film school graduate shifts the focus of his production onto the disappearance of a local resident and the strange characters who are conducting the search to find him.
Yeah, I've been around the block, kids. I know what the Search for One-Eyed Jimmy is.
Here, let me read the other one. Les is making a film about his old neighborhood in Brooklyn. One-Eyed Jimmy goes missing, and Les switches to making a film about One-Eyed Jimmy and the people searching for him. So it sounds like he cut One-Eyed Jimmy off.
Yeah, it sounds like he cut. Yeah, that's also called the Lorena Bobbitt story. So.
1995, he was in Losing Isaiah.
And he lost him.
This movie also had Halle Berry, Cuba Gooding Jr.
Yeah, dude, that movie kind of pissed me off.
Okay. The biological and adoptive mothers of a young boy are involved in a bitter, controversial custody battle.
Listen, why can't you just give this black baby up? We're rich. You're poor. You have habits. Well, the system is kind of, no. Just give the baby up. Man, yeah, that movie was like, it got all this acclaim, you know. And I was just like, that movie's kind of shitty.
Well, then let's move on to the 1995 Kiss of Death.
He plays Death.
He plays Calvin Hart.
Kiss.
No. David Caruso, hashtag Nicholas, leave Nick alone. Helen Hunt. Nice little cast there. I'm seeing a lot of Michael Rapaport. Bump that guy.
You do?
Yeah, he's been in like six of these movies.
Michael Rapaport, he was also in True Romance too, by the way.
Well, he's been like a few of these movies that I've been reading.
Well, he's dope. Like in the 90s, he was the white dude who you were like, damn, man, he's kind of cool, man. He's got a way about him that feel like he hangs out with black cats. But sometimes on his Twitter recently, you're kind of like,
He's not dope.
That's that white dude who thinks he hangs out with a lot of black cats.
1995, Die Hard with a Vengeance. Zeus.
Oh, yeah.
1995, the movie Fluke. He plays Rumbo.
Okay.
After, this movie, the description is, after a man dies in a car crash, he is reincarnated as a dog and attempts to reconnect with his family.
Okay. Oh, wait, sorry. Great.
1996, he's in Hard Eight. That's what she said.
Jesus, maturity. That's the sequel to the One-Eyed Jack.
You mean One-Eyed Jimmy?
That's the sequel to the One-Eyed Jimmy.
This movie had Gwyneth Paltrow, John C. Reilly. Oh, and speaking of that, Oz, Samuel Jackson actually does play Jimmy.
So,
and we do know eventually he does lose one eye.
Speaking of all this entanglement shit, so when Gwyneth Paltrow was getting divorced,
here we go.
Her little hippie ass, she was like, "We're not getting divorced. We're uncoupling.
We're untangling."
No, she said uncoupling.
I know, but she meant untangling.
I was like, what the fuck is uncoupling?
It's untangling.
It wasn't really messing around with someone else. It's sort of like an entanglement. I was in some briars, like, and I got all these thorns in me, you know, like first you're in the briars, you're like, it's kind of fun. But then you're like, oh shit, these thorns are getting to me. And then you're outside and your pants on the ground.
Well, here's here comes the 1996 movie, The Great White Hype.
Man,
Samuel Jackson plays Reverend Fred Salton.
When does he get eaten by a shark?
It's coming, dude. Actually, we got a few movies before we get
this
to that.
Dude. See, everybody's like, "Oh my god, Dr. Dre is the first billionaire." Samuel Jackson's like, "I'm the first black billionaire, dude." Y'all stupid. Y'all talking about Oprah Winfrey? Oprah would lose her mind if. If I had Oprah's money, I'd lose my vote. What's that Chris Rock joke? Chris Rock, I'm sorry, dude. Chris Rock was like, y'all said that Oprah Winfrey's rich. If Bill Gates woke up with Oprah Winfrey's money, he would jump out of a window and slit his throat.
That's not funny. But
it's not funny. Everybody's like, yeah, Oprah's rich. I'm like, and people are like, yo, man, Will Smith, he's rich. I'm like, man, you sell me checks. Sammy's got.
Yeah. 1996, Trees Lounge. He plays Wendell.
Oh, now listen.
Oh, here we go.
Steve Buscemi directed, I think wrote and directed that one.
Yes.
And that was a big one.
And starred. Let's give them all three.
And it's a great kind of it's a great movie. It's an ode to the movie Barfly, which is kind of like the ode his name escapes me right now, but I used to love his writings all the time. It's Charles. He was just a drunkard.
Okay.
He was just a drunkard, and I Charles Bukowski.
Oh yeah.
Charles Bukowski.
Good guy. 1996, A Time to Kill. He plays Carl Lee Haley.
Oh, that's the Matthew McConaughey, right?
Mm-hmm. Sandra Bullock, Kevin Spacey.
And that's the really good one where at the end of the movie, Matthew McConaughey asks everybody.
Hey, it doesn't matter if it's 30 years or 5 years or 2 months. Spoiler alert.
Oh, sorry. Okay, spoiler. but sorry, dude. God, this guy's passionate about the spoiler. Hey,
listen, look. I know you don't check Facebook and stuff that often, but you know, every Friday morning, I've been putting out a warning and I say, look, if I see any WandaVision spoilers, I'm blocking.
Hey, well, that's okay. But you're just like, hey. Listen, I know it was World War II, but I don't want anybody telling who won the war because that's a spoiler alert.
Well,
okay?
But it is a spoiler for kids who haven't learned that in school yet.
Oh my God, dude! It's not a spoiler for people who are like, what? What are Nazis?
All right.
If you live in America and you know what Nazis are, it ain't a spoiler. So anyway, the whole thing is the cool thing about that was Matthew McConaughey is just like. It's a crazy case, you know, where this young black girl is raped. Yeah. And he's just like, I want you to close your eyes and imagine the scenario. And everybody's closed, the jurors are closing their eyes, they're imagining the scenario and everything. And then he's like, and now I want you to imagine that, what he said, now I want you to imagine that she's black. Because it was a telling thing, because people don't know how to get themselves out of their own situation, you know?
Yeah. 1996, The Long Kiss. Yeah, great. 1996, The Long Kiss Goodnight.
Hey, Miss Menza, Gina Davis.
Okay.
There you go. Me and my friend, we would spend endless amounts of time watching Trees Lounge and The Long Kiss Goodnight.
That's good. 1997, 187.
On an undercover.
Trevor Garfield.
Is it with Lawrence Fishburne?
I do not see Lawrence Fishburne here, okay. But I do see Method Man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So shout out to Method Man. 1997, Eve's Bayou.
The husband, the wife of Bonnie Curtis Hall is Cassie Lemons, and she I think wrote and directed Eve's Bayou, and the lead girl in Eve's Bayou is the lead woman in Lovecraft Country, and that is why I love Lovecraft Country, because if you really draw a parallel, you can literally draw a parallel, because there's a lot of mythical, supernatural overtones in Eve's Bayou, which parallel the Lovecraft Country, which is concerned about black families. It's really good in Southern black families. It's good.
Mm-hmm.
It's super good.
Yeah, no doubt. 1997, Jackie Brown, Ordell Robbie.
Holy crap, dude, my boy. Yo, Sam is also in... The Caveman Valentine, too. I forgot about that one. Yeah.
1998, Sphere.
Oh, yeah.
1998.
Terrible sci-fi.
Out of Sight.
Uh-huh.
1998, The Negotiator.
Oh, that was great.
1998.
With Kevin Spacey. I know he got canceled for a good reason, but yeah, it was good.
1998, The Red Violin.
Okay, yeah.
1999. What franchise has he joined this year, Oz?
Star Wars.
Star Wars, Episode 1, The Phantom Menace, Mace Windu.
Oof,
1999.
Purple.
Deep Blue Sea. Russell Franklin.
Eaten by a shark.
Year 2000. Rules of Engagement.
Mm-hmm.
2000. Shaft.
Which is really good.
2000, Unbreakable.
Which is great, Mr. Glass.
2001, The Caveman's Valentine.
Which is brilliant. It's just a beautiful, God, so good. Another that reunites him with Cassie Lemons again in that movie, as her being director.
2001, Formula 51.
That was great. That's the best diarrhea scene ever.
2002, Changing Lanes.
Is that about road rage? Is that Ben Affleck?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, road rage and Ben Affleck. I was about to say 1992. 2002, Star Wars Episode II, Attack of the Clones.
He just like paid me, dude.
Yeah, that's when he got pretty sweet because he chopped off Jango Fett's head.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed that. 2002, No Good Deed. Okay.
Yeah,
2002, what franchise does he join this year?
I think he has to join some Marvels, right?
2002, he joins Triple X.
Oh, God, that dude.
Let's see, 2003,
that's the year where he's like, I can start getting facial scars. Okay.
2003, Basic.
This dude is in a lot of franchises.
Yeah, he's in a lot of stuff. 2003, SWAT. What famous rapper is also in SWAT, Oz?
Drake. No. famous rapper who's also in SWAT.
He was definitely your era, your time. You would have definitely known about him.
I mean, the only ones that it's either got to be either Ludacris, Exhibit, or Ja Rule.
Really? Those aren't your time.
Or Method Man or Red Man.
Those aren't your time, though.
Yeah, they are.
They're way up. No. You were like 50 when they started rap.
Whoa, that hurts.
Whoa.
I mean, because we know the truth hurts, but it still hurts.
LL Cool J.
Oh, I was also going to say 50, but good. LL, Ladies Love. Sonic Youth, Kim Gordon, you said this crazy crush on LL, and she wrote, was a cool thing about that dude. You know you're a pimp when a woman writes a kind of love song about you, admiration, and you're, and she's in a band with her husband, and the husband's like, yeah, let's keep playing it.
2004, In My Country.
He plays Nelson Mandela.
Langston Whitfield.
Okay.
A journalist and a poet meet during the hearings of South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission.
We need a Truth and Reconciliation Commission here in America, dude.
2004, Twisted.
Okay.
Okay. 2004, Kill Bill Volume 2.
Yeah.
Rufus. 2004, what franchise does he join now?
Now he's Mr. Fury.
Now he joins the Incredibles.
Okay, excuse me, dude.
Frozone.
You just like doing this.
What's coming? I mean, you know it's coming eventually. 2005, he portrays Coach Carter in Coach Carter.
Coach Carter.
2005, Triple X, State of the Union.
Now, you did say that there is an extended scene that has Ice Cube in it.
In the second one is the one with Ice Cube.
Right, but the third one that has Triple X in it, you said, didn't you tell me that there's a scene that has Ice Cube in the third one?
Spoiler alert.
You did.
But yes, Ice Cube does end up saving the day at the end of the third one. But yes, spoiler alert.
Yeah, spoiler alert. I just said it 20 times. I was like, didn't you just tell me that on the show? I didn't say that on the show today.
Not today. Oh,
God.
2005, great. Star Wars Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith.
Okay. What franchise does it join now?
2005, The Man.
Wait, who? You're the what?
No, that's the name of the movie, The Man.
No. I didn't ask what you are. I thought we were talking about all his movies. What movie did he do again?
The Man.
What are you? I know what you are. You always say it.
No, I don't
say
that.
I'm asking the movie.
No, that is the movie, The Man. Samuel L. Jackson, Eugene Levy. Anthony Mackie.
Wait, tell me one more time what the title is.
The Man.
I'm a...
No. You tried. You almost got that. 2006, Freedom Land.
South Africa.
2006, what iconic movie does he lead?
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
Wait. Iconic movie, Glory. I'm kidding. What iconic movie does he lead?
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, there's a lot of reasons you could be iconic.
Does he lead in an iconic movie? 2006.
You could almost say this is one of the first movies to really use viral marketing.
Snakes on a plane.
Okay, I mean, I don't know what else I could have told you to give it away without actually saying it.
You could have said, what movie does he play in that the animals don't have any arms or legs and he's in the air?
And he cusses. 2006, Black Snake Moan.
There's something on a something.
Black Snake Moan. He plays Lazarus.
That's a great one.
Justin Timberlake. 2006, Home of the Brave.
And not just Justin Timberlake. Don't forget about your girl. What's her name?
I'll forget about her. Christina Ricci.
Yeah, Wednesday from the Addams Family.
Oh yeah, she is in that. Okay, I'll give you that. Yeah, I rock with her. And I liked her in Casper too.
Yeah.
No doubt. True that. 2006, Home of the Brave. 2006,
South Africa. No, that's not about South Africa.
2007, Resurrecting the Champ. He plays Champ.
Okay.
2007, Afro Samurai. He voices Afro Samurai.
Oh, which is just great, dude.
2007, 1408. 2007, okay. Cleaner. 2008, Jumper.
Oh, I love Jumper, dude.
2008, Oz. What franchise sure, go ahead.
Martha Kent, right?
Martha Kent?
Right? Diane Lane is in Jumpers, isn't that right?
Oh, okay. Yeah. No, yeah, I got you. You just threw me off with Martha Kent thing.
I know.
So here we go. 2008. What franchise does he join?
DC? we got to do Marvel, dude.
It's not Marvel yet. I'll give you that hint.
Thank you. God.
No, it's not Marvel yet. I'll give you that hint.
Oh, fuck. 2008.
Yeah.
Lord of the Rings.
Is that really what you're going with?
No. Oh, Fast and Furious.
2008, Iron Man. You were right, Marvel.
God.
2008, Lakeview Terrence.
Dude, seriously, bro. What's up, man?
2008, Gospel Hill.
Hold on, we got to talk. Seriously, back up one more time. Now, when I just said Marvel, you just decided you really needed to, like, do that, right?
Yeah, it just came off the tongue. Once I started going, I couldn't stop myself.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
2008, Soul Man.
Hey, yo, that's called low impulse control. Wait, Soul Man?
With Bernie Mac.
Yeah, okay.
2008, The Spirit.
Okay.
2009, he was a narrator in Inglourious Basterds.
Okay.
2009, Mother and Child.
Okay.
2009, he was a voice of Zog in Astro Boy. 2010, Iron Man 2.
Mm-hmm.
2010, Unthinkable.
Oh, yeah.
2010, The Other Guys.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
2011, Thor.
Huh.
Oh, 2011, The Sunset Limited.
I feel like I remember that movie, yeah.
2011, Captain America, The First Avenger. 2011, Arena. Huh. 2012, The Samaritan. 2012, Meeting Evil. 2012, Avengers.
Mm-hmm.
2012, he voices Tendai. Whoa, Tendai in Avengers in Zambezia. 2012, Django Unchained.
Mm-hmm.
2013, he voices Whiplash in Turbo. 2013, Old Boy.
Oh, yeah.
2014, Reasonable Doubt.
He teams back up with Spike Lee for that.
2014, RoboCop.
Yeah, but the Hateful Eight should be coming pretty soon.
2014, Captain America Winter Soldier.
Mm-hmm.
2014, Kite.
Mm-hmm.
2014, Big Game. 2014, what franchise does he join now?
2014? I don't know.
Kingsman, The Secret Service.
Okay.
2015, Avengers, Age of Ultron. 2015, Barely Legal. 2015, She-Rock. 2015, The Hateful Eight.
Yep.
2016, Cell. 2016, The Legend of Tarzan.
The movie?
Yes.
That movie was stupid, dude.
It wasn't that. It was okay. Wasn't good, but it was a good
I hate Tarzan.
2016, Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children.
Oh, yeah. He loves playing a bad guy.
2017, Triple X, The Return of Xander Cage. 2017, Kong Skull Island.
Oh, yeah.
2017, The Hitman's Bodyguard.
Oh, the Hitman's Wife's Bodyguard is going to be pretty good.
There you go. 2017, The Unicorn Store. 2018, Avengers Infinity War. 2018, Incredibles 2.
Oh, yeah.
2018, Life Itself. 2019, Glass.
Oh, yeah.
2019, Captain Marvel. 2019, Avengers Endgame. He had a big 2019. 2019, Shaft.
Yeah, he did.
2019, Spider-Man Far From Home.
Thank God, this dude makes some money.
2019, The Last Full Measure. Let's see here. He was also, he even was in 2019, Rise of the Skywalker, Star Wars Episode 9. He was one of the voices that she heard at the end.
What? Okay.
It's he is credited for that. 2020, The Banker. Let's see here. 2020, Death to 2020, which is a Netflix special. And he's got Capital One commercials. Tons of those. So that's a hell of a catalog. That pretty much took up the whole show.
Yeah. Okay. Well, final thoughts.
Well, gotta go. Here we go. We're gonna play a quick commercial break. We're gonna come right back, and we're jumping right back into things. We'll be right back.
Welcome to the Defy Life podcast. Join JR, Thomas, and Al as they take on topics in sports, politics, current events, family, and more. Insightful, hilarious, always unique. New episode every Wednesday. Powered by the Defy Life Podcast Network. Listen at defylifepods.com and everywhere else your favorite podcasts are available. If you're not rocking with Defy Life, what's your life about?
And we are back. Make sure you are checking out the Defy Life podcast, our flagship of the network. Oz, are you ready for the Kilmonger conversation?
I am ready.
Our good friend Philip Darnall has sent us another one. As always, we appreciate it. You can send those either in the DMs, send them to me, or send them to Oz. If you send them to Oz, we'll get to them next month. If you send them to me, we'll get to them next week. Twitter, Facebook, however you want to get up to us. Email, neformarvelversedc@gotofilelife.com.
Don't we have a voicemail number, too?
We do, 804-518-6631.
Thank you, sir.
No problem. For the conversations, both Killmonger and Regular, if you were to come out with comic movies for the next 5 years for both DC and Marvel, which five for each would you pick? They can be teams or individuals. Hashtag, these hashtags are very interesting, Oz. You might like a couple of these. Hashtag leave Nick alone. Hashtag Star Trek rocks. Hashtag Nick needs a Starfleet uniform. Hashtag why can't we all just get along? Hashtag be nice to Dick Grayson. Hashtag leave Oz alone.
Yeah. Now, I will say I appreciate the last one sincerely. Thank you as always. I'm not sure about leaving Dick Grayson alone.
Well, Oz, let's keep it 100. You can't really leave Dick alone.
Dick can't leave himself alone.
Okay, so what does that have to do with you?
So what I was thinking was that it would be kind of cool, since they're always constantly trying to figure out what to do with this dude, literally what to do with Dick. Why not put a patch over his eye and you can call him the one-eyed Dick?
One-eyed Jimmy? One-eyed Dickie.
Give him a sidekick that's called the one-eyed Jimmy.
One-eyed Dickie. All right, so how do you want to do this? Do you want to go one by one? Do you want to just give your five for each?
Let's go one by one. You want to start Marvel or you want to start DC?
I'll start with DC.
Okay.
I'm going to start with my guy, Dick Grayson. This is an idea I've brought up before. I think it's a different way to bring it up or bring him and introduce him to the world. I think it'd be just a different concept in general. But I would introduce Dick Grayson in a Grayson style movie. It wouldn't be called Grayson. It would be called Spiral, and it would be all about him as a spy. And throughout the entire movie, you don't know it's Dick Grayson. You think it's just a random spy that you're following throughout this entire thing. And then at the very end of the movie, after he's figured out whatever he needed to do, he gets a message. It could be a nice little after credit scene. He gets a message. He goes and answers it. And of course, it's Batman. And you realize that this is Dick Grayson who has infiltrated Spiral, and that leads you. It can open up a plethora of doors to that world. This movie would introduce Midnighter to the world. That would be top of my list. I just think that is a concept and a movie that would be easy to make, and it's a different take on things that could get people, and it's a nice twist.
I like it. I would do a Legion of Superhero story. People like Justice League, just do Justice League set in the future. That way you can go bonkers with your CGI and conceptualize, explore different alien life forms still under a common thread of evil versus good. So,
okay. I'm going to stick with the DC world. I would go with a Black Canary Green Arrow movie. And I would do it with, and my Black Canary will be white as well. I would also do it in kind of a different style. Instead of it being more of a serious, it'd be more of a buddy cop movie, you know, or buddy cop style. And Black Canary would definitely kind of be the leader in this group. And Green Arrow would be the, you know, the comic relief, but he could more than hold his own. And that would be my next pick. I would go with those two.
I would do a Earth 2 society style movie, and just kind of open it up with like a picture of the Earth, and then have the screen get blurred so you see that it's an alternate universe, it's an alternate multiverse, and that way we could get ourselves a Black Superman, still have a romance with Supergirl in it, and we can introduce ourselves to a new list of characters while telling how the old Trinity died, you know? I thought that would be really cool.
Okay. I am going to go with a Lady Shiva movie, and I would have it in the vein of her becoming the most feared assassin and warrior in the world. It would kind of show her training and her eventually beating whoever the number one was at the time. And that would be my movie to kind of establish her. You could even establish her in this same universe as the big bad. And to go back on to connect it all, I would even introduce Connor Hawk maybe in my Green Arrow movie. And you could have him show up in this movie. And you could have like a Tim Drake show up in this movie. Like, there's a lot of people that could show up. You could do flashbacks to showing her and showing her in the present time, maybe training or fighting people and just kind of going through people and then showing the training and how she got to this dominant physical point. So Lady Shiva would be my next pick.
I'll throw you a bone. I would do a Robin Dick Grayson story, but tell it as an origin story. And have Batman be on the peripheral, even like from him, like training to him going on his first caper, like from the miniseries, The Gauntlet. Yeah.
So my next one, I'm going to kind of change things up a little bit. I'm going to be a little bit different and not follow any type of continuity from the comics. This is where I might make some people mad. I would do a Mr. Terrific story. Now, with Mr. Terrific, I would have him being an apprentice, or not being, I would have him have an apprentice and someone kind of learning from him very closely that he works with. You know, he's a very intelligent guy. So a very intelligent young lady will be working very closely with him. And this is also how I would introduce Natasha Irons, and kind of how she's able to get some of this technology, how, you know, and where, not where her intelligence comes from, but where she's able to kind of mold it and really form it to be able to make things how she wants to. So I would introduce Mr. Terrific and use that as a gateway to introduce Natasha Irons. You get your John Irons. And I think that's a different way to introduce them. You could even get to a Plastic Man that way. So a lot of different things you could do there. So that's Mr. Terrific and Natasha Irons team up would be the next one.
Well, that'd be cool. Man. Oh, maybe something like a Green Lantern Corps, but it's like have it set out in space, not on Earth.
Okay. For my fifth one. Now, this one's a little bit harder because I don't have I feel like you need like a big team up or I need some type of, for everything I've laid out, I don't have any type of like superpowered people. I don't have a superpowered movie or anything like that. So this is where I would probably go with maybe like, I think I might kind of go with your idea, Oz, and go with like an Earth 2. Cause I actually, and I'm going to take this right on the spot cause I really like that idea. I would go with the Earth 2 where you kill off the Trinity. And you have to kind of start anew. I really like that idea, and I think that's another different idea that would work really well. So, I'm piggybacking it off of that.
Love it.
And you? Your fifth?
Wait, I already did my five. I was the first one.
No, I was the first one because I did Dick Grayson.
Son of a crappers. Let's go balls out. I'll do a Plastic Man movie.
Okay. Marvel. We'll start with you on the Marvel side.
Karnak.
That was
about a movie about the Inhuman set here. Like the limited series where he helps S.H.I.E.L.D. out every once in a while, solve cases, because he'd be an awesome detective.
For me, I am going to go with Gambit. It's my favorite character, so I'd go with the Gambit movie. I don't really have any specific thing except, you know, I'd like a lot of espionage in this movie. Really let him show off how light-footed and easy he is to get around and get where he needs to go, and his stealth abilities really get that over. So I'd go with a Gambit movie.
Man. Thinking. like to see an Iron Fist movie, but the Iron Fist storyline where they're in Shangri-La and in the different hidden forbidden cities where they're and they're fighting each other. So
I know this isn't a. I wish we could do TV shows because I would do a Luke Cage, Jessica Jones TV show in the style of a Deadpool movie or like a Harley Quinn type TV show where it's just them raising their kids, you know, as a biracial couple and having a biracial, well, not a biracial couple, but having a biracial kid and just how that works, them being superpowered on top of all that. I think there could be a lot of humor. And it could be something different as well. So I would go with a Luke Cage, Jessica Jones, very adult-ish type funny movie.
Mm. Okay, I like it. I would probably do maybe a Jessica Walters She-Hulk movie.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. She needs one.
I would have Jessica... I would have her... I would have her do a crossover TV movie with Law and Order.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I like it.
Yeah, I'm taking your idea on that one.
I know you stole it. Yeah. Oh, you thief. I would do... Dude. Maybe I would like to see something not quite rated R, but more grittier. And it would be... I'm on the fence. I'd either want to do a Morlock movie about mutants who live in the sewers and underground on the fringe, or I would want to do House of M.
That's good. I would do a Stryker movie, and I kind of bash, I'm not really a big fan of this, but I think it's an easy story that I'm surprised hasn't been done yet. You could easily do a Stryker movie from the perspective of, he's trying to help the mutants and then a mutant ends up turning on him and maybe kills his family. And that's where his real hatred and why he has this vendetta against mutants start. Or maybe it's even on some Homelander type stuff and the mutant impregnates his wife.
Or something crazy.
Something crazy like that. And that's why the hatred starts. Because not only did he... Now does he have a mutant son that he has to take care of. But his wife cheated on him with a mutant. So something ridiculous like that. So I would do a Stryker movie and show how his hatred for mutants starts.
Maybe... I wonder if the world's ready for a Deathlok movie. The black military... guy who's like cyborg too.
Okay, they tried to introduce him on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, they did, didn't they?
Man, I'd reboot Blade.
You can't do that. They're already doing that.
But that is what I would do though. But that's fine. Let's see here. Let me go with. Let me go with a Pepper Potts movie. No. Hey, what's Tony Stark's what's the butler's name? The driver.
Oh, Jarvis.
Happy.
Oh, okay, got it. Yeah.
Happy. Yeah, I would do a Happy movie.
Well, you want to do a Happy movie, good. That's cute.
Or either a Happy movie or a movie with the guy from Ant-Man who recaps everything. Recapping the entire Marvel Cinematic Universe to different people at different reasons at different times.
That makes sense. Yeah.
So yeah, that would be my Marvel movies.
Nice.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Great.
All right. That's enough of you for tonight. Oz, final thing we got to do is get to the WandaVision episodes 7 and 8. A lot of stuff has happened. Big spoiler alerts. I'm going to play this one more time. I know Oz doesn't care about spoiler alerts, but I care.
Lame.
Great. Oz, what are your thoughts on episodes 7 and 8?
Oh, they were great. I liked the introduction to Agatha Harkness.
Agatha Harkness.
Harkness. But I kind of like the old traditional Agnes, not this new thing. I loved the Scarlet Witch reference. And I love seeing our man Vision. I still want to see who this crazy guest star is going to be appearing next week. So yeah, it was really good. I like the latest ones because you get to see the backstory behind everything and just how she's trying to deal with her grief and stuff, you know. And we forget she lost her brother and her lover. So
my biggest takeaway from this was I really missed Monica, Darcy, and Wu. And yeah, as much as this is a WandaVision show, I feel like those three have really kind of become the stars of the show. And that's not a knock on Elizabeth Olsen, who's done a great job with the role she has. But, man, I feel like those three have really kind of, like, this show really missed them without having them in the episode at all.
Well, I kind of like not having them because I like the fact that we got to see Elizabeth act and do the stages of her of acting. Now, I can tell you for sure they'll be heavy duty in the last one since they didn't appear in this one. So, you know, and it makes sense that they didn't want to do it because the last time you saw Monica with Quicksilver, but then you realize Quicksilver was a manifestation of what Agatha did.
Right, but
mm-hmm.
Well, do we know that? Or is he from another realm? Like, what if he's from another universe or something?
Yeah, but she's, well, maybe when Wanda was trying to conjure him, she just she kind of tweaked it a little bit. But still, you know, we still have to see what he is.
Yeah, that's very true. It's going to be very important to know what he is. A couple of the rumors that have come, well, not rumors, but just a couple of the theories that have come out is that he is Mephisto.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how true that is. It'll be interesting to see what happens. I don't think he'll be playing a role going forward as far as what he, I don't think we'll see any Quicksilver action. You know, I don't think we'll see any big moments from him. I think this will be the family. I see this ending in heartbreak. I see her ending up alone at the end of all this.
Well, I mean, if we could keep to the storyline where Vision gets online, but he is just—he has to regain his soul again.
Like, well, there's two Visions.
Well, there's only one really, because like there's the real Vision that is like that the government recreated again and put online, and then there's just the Vision that was just basically just a manifestation of Wanda, like the kids are. What Wanda's going to find out and what Agatha is going to have over her head is that the two kids in Vision, she's using them, but they're just Wanda.
But in that town, that Vision has powers and is in well, and is
and has its own conscious. So I think what will probably happen is to the glory of Marvel. Just to kind of wrap things up and bring Vision back is she will face some heartache and she's going to lose those twins.
She's going to lose everything. I think she loses everything.
I think she does too, but I think she is at the very end, what is left of Vision from that town will be put into that synthetic Vision because she'll see the synthetic Vision and she'll be like, Vision, and he's just a droid. So she'll be able to put that little bit of soul because basically that Vision that's in town is the one is Wonder Man, is Simon. So she'll put that into that synthetic Vision and get him back to where he was.
See, I don't even think it's going to have that.
That's my spoiler alert.
I don't even think it's going to have that happy of an ending. I think everything is just like she's going to have to kill Vision again. That's what I think is going to happen. I think she's going to have to kill him again, and she's going to have to get rid of her kids.
Well, I think she's going to have to take all that energy back. You know,
that's what I'm saying. Like, and but so that means she's going to have to like it's going to be her decision to get rid of everything.
Well, we'll see what happens with it because I think maybe the three supporting characters are going to have a voice in like helping her get Vision back.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so too. It's going to be very.
You remember, Monica's she her powers let her transcend through that illusion.
This is true. This is true. And she is starting to figure out her powers, and they're starting to manifest more and more. So I'm as you are. I'm curious to see what this cameo is going to be. I think there's a lot of pressure on it. You know, especially after the Mandalorian's cameo was just mind blowing. This one's got a lot of pressure on it, you know, and obviously if it disappoints, it's okay if the episode's still great. But if it's not a good episode and the cameo disappoints, we might have a little pushback on this episode.
Oh, I think so. So let's see.
Yeah. Let's see, Oz.
Great.
Any closing thoughts on WandaVision?
No, it was, man, that show was really, it was a cool ride, and I just appreciated her acting ability. You know, she's got some range.
Last question: what would be your WandaVision? This is a popular trend going around on Twitter. What would be your four TV shows?
Oh man, the ones that really got me through, huh? Okay, so. Oh God, it sucks. Sorry. Battlestar Galactica, the original Battlestar Galactica.
Bears Battlestar Galactica.
Beats Bears Battlestar. And then there would be Battlestar Galactica.
Star Trek.
The Cosby Show. Star Trek with the next generation. It was important, but how pathetic. and then I don't know, Watchmen, to keep it current.
I can't believe we spent an hour talking about Samuel Jackson.
Yeah, I can't believe you made us spend an hour talking about Samuel Jackson.
Well, you wanted to comment on every movie we went through. And we were still in the '80s, and he won nothing but just the mailman.
Samuel was like, "Yo, man, I cash some checks, dude."
okay. My four would be Boy Meets World.
Jesus!
All that.
What's her name? Topanga.
Topanga. Whew. All that. Probably Power Rangers.
And The Office.
No, because it can't be current. Well, I guess she did have a current one. I guess I do need a current one. So I guess,
yeah, that's why I said.
Yeah, no, you're right. You're right.
I would change mine to Office though.
I might go off. I might go Office too.
Yeah.
No, you know what? You know what? Instead of Power Rangers, no, I'm gonna go This Is Us.
Oh my God.
I'll go Office. I think you're. Thank you. I'll go Office.
You can bite off me all day long, dude. You know it's okay.
Nah, it's okay. I won't bite off you. You're right. I don't want to bite off you anymore. So I'll stick with what they did. I'll go Modern Family.
Jeez, yeah, okay. But both shows were great, dude. It was cool.
Yeah, it was very well done. I feel like if anyone was not comic readers and they watched this, I feel like the twist would have worked really well. So, and it worked really well for people who did know. Job well done. Looking forward to the finale. We'll definitely talk about that next week. Next week, we will also reveal the full 64 character bracket for the tournament we are conducting.
Whether you're ready for it or not.
At least
whether we're ready for it or not.
Yeah, we're going to try to do 64. We'll see if we can. We'll see what happens. We might only get like 32.
Yeah, we are now at 21.
No, we got more. All right, Oz. Obviously, we have to get to the final blow, so I figure the appropriate theme music, it's very short for this one, would be a little Agatha. So, Oz, you won't be able to hear this because I actually already pre-recorded this one and have it played, so you won't be able to hear this one playing until the new song plays.
I do have a question for you.
What's up, big guy?
You were in such a rush to get ready. We're not going to do any news tidbits, huh?
Yeah, we can't do any news tidbits.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, Samuel Jackson.
Thanks a lot, regular Scott.
All right, what you got for the final blow?
I've been having some discussions with some folks about this Michael B. Jordan possibly playing Superman.
Oh, you said you're going to get your news tidbit in, huh?
I'm going to get mine in, dude. It's my final blow. I just want to say that. Look, man, who cares? Let him. He can be T'Challa. He can be Kilmonger. He can be Johnny Storm. He can be anybody. But he does not need to be Kal-El, Clark Kent. Because that is just people who aren't listening to the movement that we're in, that the times we're in. There's so much stuff we can do. We've always Sandman. There's all these other characters. There's Calvin Ellis, the black Superman, who's modeled after Obama. But there's also the cat who's from, who's Bao, whatever his name is. He's from Earth to Society. And he's dope, man. And I think there's potential with that. So we should, like, really think hard about these choices, you know, and listen to the people, you know. DC, stop fucking up.
Yeah, I definitely hear that. I like this music. This might become a regular occurrence with this one.
I know it's really, it's definitely off of that. It has that Bewitch, I Dream a Genie vibe. It's really nice.
Yeah, I like it a lot. I'm very happy with it. What about you?
It'll do.
It'll do.
It's great. It's great.
Great. So again, make sure you follow us on Twitter, Knee4MarvelVsDC. That's the number 4. You can email us, Knee4MarvelVsDC at GoToFireLife.com. I have just finished the Chimara Ant arc on Hunter x Hunter, and I have to say, I don't think it's as great as everyone says it was. It was not my favorite arc so far. I enjoyed the Dark Tournament, or the Dark Tournament, that's UU. I enjoyed the first arc and the Kurapika arc, where he uses the chains. I enjoyed both of those a lot more than that, so I'm hoping the Dark Continent arc is a lot better. But we'll find out about that. Oz, you should definitely check out Hunter x Hunter.
Well, you keep bringing it up. I'm going to have to start watching it.
I definitely think you should. I think it's really good, and you should definitely check it out. So, Oz, tell everyone where they can find you on Twitter before you go.
As usual, you can find me at Ozzy Real, OZZIERELL. Wait, REAL.
And Oz, tell everyone you talk to them next time.
Hey, folks, as usual, it's been great. I mean, peace and chicken grease.
And y'all have a good time, because we're going to have a good time until we talk to y'all next time. Peace.
Samuel Jackson has a lot of money.
Great.
Malcolm in the Middle. So funny.
This is Defy Life.
You know, what you doing on a Sunday?